لله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد ونعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. On Monday, about 4 days ago, I was at the Lake Villa Public Library, maybe about an hour or so from here. So we arranged a program there called Islam 101. So this was Monday night. The weather was cold. I thought it was raining, not raining, it was snowing. So when I went up there, about 6:50 p.m., the program was to start at 7. I was expecting maybe 10 people, 15 people come there. But lo and behold, as I went there, about 40 to 45 people waiting there to start the program. Alhamdulillah. So after the program was done, after we were done with the main presentation, there was a Q&A session. In the Q&A session, you'll be surprised to find out, or maybe not surprised, all the questions, every single question was a misconception that they had about Islam and Muslims. One question was about the Sharia. Hey, what is the Sharia law? We hear so many things about it. One question was about the Sunni and the Shia. You know, I joked with them and I said, no open house, no presentation is complete if that question is not asked, right? People ask that, people want to know that how come there is infighting between the Muslims? Who are the Sunnis? Who are the Shias? One question was about extremism. So there were so many questions, and the Q&A session was about 1 hour. And as I was giving the answers, the responses, I was thinking to myself, you know, just imagine if this presentation was not done, if they were not educated about Islam, what would be the way of life of these individuals? Well, first and foremost, they would be deprived of the teachings of Islam. Secondly, if they keep on holding the misconceptions, it is going to reflect not only on their person, it is going to reflect in their interaction with the Muslims, who they elect, the foreign policy. Many things about Islam and Muslims living here will be affected if these 45 individuals, if they don't have knowledge of Islam. Maybe in their neighborhood, in the Lake Villa, you know, every single person who came there was a white Caucasian brother or sister. Suppose if a Muslim would have moved in their neighborhood, if they don't have knowledge about Islam, if they still have the fear of the unknown, the misconceptions, they would be fearful of that person living next to them as a neighbor. Suppose if they have to elect between two individuals, they may elect that person who may be supporting the Muslim ban. So a really important lesson, a point for you and me is that yes, we have speaking about Dawah as an obligation, but if we don't do Dawah, what is the status of the non-Muslims and how it is going to reflect on us, how it is compromising our life, our person, our rights, not in, just in the US, but around the world. And unfortunately, what is going on in Assam and in Kashmir and in China and all over the India, may Allah protect all the Muslims. May Allah protect all the oppressed people around the world. So my khutbah today is, what are the 7 lessons that we can learn? What are the 7 habits that we can inculcate within ourselves so we can attain or try to attain that same position that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, gave to the first generation, and they were labeled as the best of all the generations in the history of humanity. So if we are down here, if we need to pull us ourselves up here, there has to be some process and there has to be some attributes that we need to inculcate. So what were the attributes of the best of all the generations that we can emulate so we can, inshallah, not only be a force of goodness in the society, inshallah, we can have the success, we can have the unity, we can have, inshallah, Allah's honor and blessing And inshallah, the best honor, the best blessing, the best reward would be eternal paradise in Jannat al-Firdaus. So the very first habit that I have for all of us as a reminder coming from the Quran and the Sunnah, this is that we should have a mission in our lives. The Muslim Ummah has to have a mission. Right now our mission, we think, or unconsciously we may believe that our mission is to work from 9 to 5. Majority of our time, our waking hours are spent on just working, or our hobbies, or our families. But that is not the mission in life. Going to work, or getting a degree, or raising a family is not the mission in life, because even the non-Muslims are doing exactly the same. So our missions, our purpose in life should be something higher, something bigger, and something more impactful. So what is the mission that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to the Muslim Ummah? That mission is defined in the Quran. In Surah number 2, Surah Baqarah, ayah number 143, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ وَيَكُونَ الرَّسُولُ عَلَيْكُمْ شَهِيدًا. And the ayah continues, so the mission that Allah has given to you and me and the Muslim Ummah is to make sure that we become witnesses to humanity. That is the mission. The way the Messenger of Allah was a witness over us. So if there is one mission, one goal of every single prophet, every single messenger, yes, they used to feed the poor, they used to be good to their neighbors, with a smile they used to interact with all the people, but that was not the mission. But their mission was to invite humanity to La ilaha illallah. So yes, so one action item for this masjid and for all of us and the Muslim Ummah is, just like we have a full-time imam, a resident scholar in this masjid, just like we may have a full-time youth director in this masjid, every single masjid, starting with the bigger masajids, we should have a full-time dawah lead in every single masjid. Yes. And all the activities, suppose if we are expanding the masjid or building a new masjid, mashallah, 248 highway or I mean the street, I'm not sure, Naperville is, you know, every single week a new masjid is coming up, mashallah. So every masjid, yes, praying is good, we need to come and pray here, but we need to align the activities of the masjid with the purpose, the mission that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to us. So that is the number one. That means the mission that we should have individually, as families, as a masjid, and obviously as the Muslim Ummah. The second important attribute or the resources that we need to invest, if we need to pull ourselves from the stagnation, would be to invest in the youth. So the good news is this. You know, two days ago, I was at the Niles West High School. They had an interfaith program. The Muslims and the Christians and the Jews and the Hindus, they arranged a program, different speakers. I was there from the Muslim side. Lo and behold, there were about 50 youth sitting up there, high schoolers. Majority of them, about 95%, they were Muslims, mashallah. So the good news is that more Muslim youth are becoming activists, gaining knowledge. They are in the front line of activism. That is the good news. But the bad news is that the percentage of Muslim youth who are involved in pre-marital intimacy, number of youth who are taking drugs, Muslim youth I'm saying, right? Not the non-Muslims. Number of youth who say the LGBT is okay. Number of youth who are smoking hookah and smoking cigarettes. All of the statistics and the data, it's rising. About 30 to 50% of our Muslim youth, they're involved in either one of these activities. May Allah protect them and all of us from these activities. But that is not the bad news. The worst news is that about 20% of our Muslim youth, they are becoming atheist, agnostic, or Christians. I mean, I can cry all day, all night, even if one Muslim becomes a non-Muslim. You know, 20%, according to the Pew Research Survey, the number of people that we are adding, that many number of people we are losing. So an important action item for this masjid and all of us as parents, as older individuals, and the Muslim Ummah, that every single masjid should have a youth director. In the masjid that I go to, MEC Masjid and MCC Masjid, they have a youth director for the sister youth and for the brothers, the young Muslim brothers. And the purpose of the youth director should not be just to give them tarbiyah, how to pray, having sports, mashallah, you know, socializing with them, eating with them. All of them needs to be done, but we need to create programs that are going to align with the concerns, the questions that our youth may be having when they are looking at the social media. There are so many channels out there, so much social media, you know, videos and lectures and books out there that are creating fitna amongst the youth. So we need to make sure the youth programs in this masjid, around the country, around the world, should align towards how to protect the youth from becoming non-Muslims. And may Allah protect all of us from that. So that's number two. Number three important area that we need to invest if we need to pull ourselves out from the stagnation would be, we need to have unity and diversity amongst the Muslim Ummah. And that was the example of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. You know, when we look at the very first and the best of all generations, the coalition of the Sahaba, the noble companions, some of them used to be from Rome, some from Persia, some from Yemen, some from Syria, some from Africa. There were some who used to be ex-Jewish, ex-Hindus, ex-Christians. They all used to come together and the Prophet empowered them. So there was unity and there was diversity. So mashallah, this masjid, along with GainPeace, we have many, many good programs about taking care of our new Muslim brothers and sisters. But that is only step number one. Step number two would be, they should be fully integrated to such an extent that they should be part of the board of directors, presidents of this masjid, principals of the school, Sunday school teachers, imams giving khutbas from here. So they should be that much integrated. I cannot say, you cannot say that we are Muslim Ummah of United States of America if majority of us coming over here are either Indian, Pakistani, Bangladeshi, Sri Lankan, Arab or African. You know, Islam is the fastest growing faith in the Latino population. They are about 24% of the Muslims in the US, they're Caucasian. About 33% are African American. About 18% are from the Latino background. But when we look at all of us, mashallah, we are here. But they are there, some other place. Maybe they are not coming. We need to identify, we need to integrate them, and then we need to empower them so they can be in the front line with us in activism. So that is an important area, unity and diversity within the Muslim Ummah. The next important area that we need to invest is media. Media is power right now. Media is power, we all know that. You know, Malcolm X, Rahimullah, he made a statement one time. He said, look at the power of the media. It can demonize a person who is innocent and then do the vice versa. Look at the power of the media. The Yahud, the Hindus, the evangelical Christian, the Islamophobes, they are heavily utilizing the media. Excellent utilization from them. There is no reason that we as Muslims, that we should be behind them when it comes to utilizing the medium. So alhamdulillah, on behalf of GainPeace, what we did was, we had a billboard on Highway 294, and the billboard said, Jesus in the Quran and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Bible, right? Just flipping it. Jesus in the Quran and Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the Bible. And then it is the philosophy of GainPeace that we want to make sure that we involve the media. Because when we involve the media, we can amplify our message. So we had a press conference last month. And we sent out a lot of press release for them to come and to cover us so we can be shown on the media. So what happened was, alhamdulillah, on the day of the event, I got ready going from Skokie to Oak Brook in the IGNA Center and received a call. When I picked up the phone, I was not able to recognize the ID, the phone number. And the lady on the other line, she said that this is, I'm calling from Fox News. I said, alhamdulillah. And she said that we want to come and cover the press conference. I said, alhamdulillah. Look at the ways that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala works. Even Fox News, he is using to propagate the truth of Islam. So not only they came, they were the first people to come, they came there, and alhamdulillah, they covered two times, the 5 p.m. news and the 9 p.m. prime time news. Not for 10 seconds, not for 20 seconds, but a whole 49 seconds each time. Alhamdulillah. Not only they covered 49 seconds, just imagine Fox News to their 2 million followers in the Chicagoland area. Their anchor person, he say that Muslims don't believe that Jesus to be God or Son of God. They believe him only to be as a prophet of God. And that is the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is helping us. Even though the billboard was $7,000, I think every single penny was worth spending into it. And the last two important attributes we can have is that we need to be involved in the social justice. And I always say we cannot win the fight for social justice for the Muslims if we don't equally stand up for the social justice of our African Americans, our Latino people, Native Americans, or any people, any individual, any families who are oppressed. We have to be equally standing up with the same passion, with the rallies, with the busload of people going there, as we stand up for Kashmir and Burma and China and India or anywhere in the world. Because that was the example of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So just to summarize, that alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the roadmap. In Surah Ahzab, ayah number 33, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهُ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرَةِ وَذَكَرَ اللَّهُ كَثِيرًا. Then in the person of Muhammad, peace be upon him, you have the best example to follow. For those who believe in Allah and the last day and remembers Allah much. So if we are here thinking and pondering why things are happening to us, maybe we need to also think that what is the cause of our situation. Yes, we can react, we should do dua, we should do activism, but we always need to know what is the reason why we are in the situation. It is perhaps we may have left those attributes that the noble companions and the noble prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used to have. If we inculcate those, inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will equally give us that honor, those blessings, the reward, the unity, and yes, the power, and yes, the blessings that we all need. So I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that to unite the Muslims, our hearts and minds. And we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that to protect all the Muslims around the world, to give them patience, to give them security, and to give them freedom. And the people who are oppressing, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also give them hidayah, so they would know that Islam is not a fate of threat. Islam is a religion of peace and is a guidance for all of humanity. With that,
Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah, wa ala alihi, wa sahabihi al-mayna ma'bad. Wa na'udhu billahi min ash-shaytani rajeem, bismillahi r-rahmani r-raheem. Inna Allah wa malaikatuhu yasalluna ala nabi, ya ayyuhal lazina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad, wa ala ali sayyidina Muhammad wa barik wa sallam. ربنا آتينا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا أو أخطأنا ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملته على الذين من قبلنا ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين آخر السلام.